It's a pleasure to be here, and for CEGA putting it on. This work is joint with my colleague Felipe Dizon, who's at the World Bank. The project started with what is a really striking impression when you arrive in Haiti, which is the prevalence of these lotto stalls that are really just everywhere, in urban areas, in rural areas, as you can see, peri-urban. And Haitians really love their lottery. I mean, they play enough that it really is maybe the first thing that strikes you as you leave the airport in Haiti. That combined with this fact that behavioral finance has really legitimized gambling as a topic, a research topic among economists. I mean, it wasn't so long ago that because we didn't have models to fit it, that we sort of dismissed it as something that was irrational and not worthy of serious study. So the combination of these two things sort of sets the stage for this project. To just give you a bit of a sense of how much they love the lottery, even among very, very poor people, and Haiti is a very poor place, very food insecure, subject to frequent shocks and the kinds of things that make the headlines here each time a storm rolls through. And yet, in that context, something like 40% of all Haitians play the lottery regularly. In urban areas, that's almost certainly closer to 70%. And they're playing with really big stakes relative to income. So between 25 and 30% of daily income wagered on the lottery. You frequently hear these stories of women hawking fruit on the street corner. They'll make $4 on the street corner on their way home at the evening lottery. They'll put a dollar or two on the lottery. And with the vast majority of Haitians unbanked, these lottery transactions are far and away the most familiar financial transactions. So just a little bit more about the lottery world in Haiti to set the stage for this. Somewhat ironically, the lottery is perceived as being really the most kind of reliable thing, the most reliable part of daily life, and that's because the numbers are drawn from the New York State Lottery. So the numbers are drawn predictably twice a day. Everyone trusts that they haven't been fudged, and so there is this kind of reliability and transparency to it. The dominant game structure looks like this. This is a lottery with a number choice, which becomes important in the design of this experiment, where you choose a two-digit number. They construct, using the New York lottery numbers, they construct a three two-digit number sequence from the lottery numbers that are drawn. And then if your chosen number matches any one of those three pairs, you get sort of payoffs according to which place it matches. So when you add this up, it has an expected return of minus 20%. But there's a lot of other more complex games that are based on the same sort of three pairs of numbers. And the last thing that's important to note is that the number choice is really, really important as part of the experience. And that's because these numbers are sort of wrapped up in dream interpretation, and there's a whole menu of sort of number and dream image kind of concordances. Like so if you have a certain dream images, they translate into a particular set of numbers. So this is almost like a religious expression to many. In terms of how the lottery plays out, it plays out across these franchise-like stalls, 35, 40,000 of these stalls that are linked to maybe four or five powerful lotto companies. The World Bank actually, they nearly tapped the lotto industry as a way to kind of promote financial inclusion, because there's no institution in Haiti that has reach across the country like the lotto industry does. We're going to be partnering with this Haitian firm that has authorization from the Ministry of Finance to conduct lotteries via SMS. So they have a digital lottery system. It's the same, essentially the same games, but and the same lotto numbers drawn from the New York State Lottery, but drawn drawn and played from phones using SMS. The SMS system that they use, the one that we're going to be using, is based on the mobile money, the Moncash mobile money system that Digicel has built up. Okay, so with that backdrop, the question we're going to ask here is can we leverage that passion for the lottery among the working poor in a way that creates a gateway to financial inclusion? And we're gonna do that first by developing a prototype lottery-linked savings product that takes the actual SMS-based lottery service and combines it with a mobile money savings product to create this lottery-linked savings prototype. It is a specific prize-linked savings. There's actually been a few of these studies, one in South Africa with Sean Cole and co-authors, one in Mexico here with Paul Gertler and co-authors, that looks at a prize-linked savings product, a little bit of a different, different design, and with sort of middle-income salaried workers. We're going to be looking at, in a very poor place among working poor, very food insecure, whether this kind of a lottery-linked savings product might divert financial activity into savings. So what we find is that offering this lottery-linked savings product in this lab in the field experiment increases savings by 22%, maybe more, and there's some heterogeneity in the results that I think is sort of interesting and sensible. And then it really appears that it's the presence of a lottery in lieu of interest that really draws people into saving, much more than the kind of the extent of the lottery component. Okay, so the some of the motives here, and I'll just touch on this, there's a lot of different reasons why you might think the poor are playing the lottery this much and this regularly. The potential benefits of lottery-linked savings, I mean, these in this context are pretty clear. First, winning is a lot more exciting than saving. It sort of fits into kind of this cultural norm, as I said, where playing numbers and sort of discussing numbers and dreams is a big part of how people sort of engage with in social settings. And so the background motive, I mean, there's a couple of different models you can think of for explaining this kind of lottery play. The one we're going to be basically using is a lumpy goods with liquidity constraints model, which is similar to what Sylvain Herskowitz, who finished here with a PhD a few years ago, he studied soccer betting in Uganda, had a similar model. This is consistent with a lot of lottery models that hinge on these transformational sums. The idea that there's a big sum of money that could transform your life, but all of those implicitly also invoke sort of a truncated planning horizon, that it's a big sum and that there's some constraint on getting to that sum through savings. So the question we ask is, can a lottery-linked savings product, can it help to reveal a viable pathway to these savings goals and do that by kind of extending planning horizons? Okay, so the only thing I'll note here before we get to the design, I think this idea of endogenous planning horizons is really interesting. It's very relevant to us in this context. I mentioned that that these models of gambling that Sylvain and others and that we've developed all sort of implicitly have this notion of a truncated planning horizon. Lajah, 2017, he has a nice model that endogenizes planning horizon, and it's sort of a self-preservation mechanism. So in his words, the model that he has generates a trade-off for the poor for whom the utility from future anticipation is experienced as distress or disutility, but not for the non-poor for whom this anticipation is a source of savoring. So if the future is gloomy, we have sort of built-in mechanisms that prompt us to turn a blind eye on that future. Okay, so this, as I said, we're going to talk about lottery play here as if it's purposeful, What I mean by that here is that this is from a master's thesis that a student of mine did. You see here that something like between this orange and the blue, something like 80% of lottery play is self-reported to be purposeful. It's to achieve a goal. It's to achieve a goal, or it's as sort of an investment. As an investment. So these two areas, and we find the same thing in ours. So this is lottery play that's purposeful in a sense, that fits that model of kind of transformational sum, liquidity constraints, and truncated planning horizon. So here's the in the experimental design, we're going to build on an existing design, sort of modify it for our context. First thing we do is we design this prototype lottery linked savings product. This is in collaboration with Digicel, the phone company, and with the SMS Lotto company. 306 subjects from these peri-urban locations near Port-au-Prince. The majority were very poor, very food insecure. 16 sessions with about 20 participants in each session. And then all the payments were made by the mobile money system. About $2.50 a show up fee and about another $5 paid out through their performance in the experiment. So the design in each experiment, the design was such that the participants had six allocation decisions. They were given a lump sum, and then in each round they allocated that lump sum of 300 gourd across six decisions, built up to six decisions. So they could either allocate it to consumption, which had a front end delay of 2 weeks. That would be paid out by mobile money directly 2 weeks after the experiment. They could allocate it to savings, which was allocated in 8 weeks with an interest payment, also allocated via mobile money. Or they could allocate it to this lotto-linked savings product. And in that case, it was distributed by mobile money. A portion of it was returned in mobile money, and a portion of it was returned at the end of 8 weeks in the form of this SMS Lotto credit. Right, so essentially, it was sort of another part of their mobile money wallet, but it was earmarked for as Lotto credit. They were all paid with this front end delay, and then they were sort of one of those rounds was randomly chosen to be paid out. So here's the structure of the experiment. This looks really big here now. The practice was just practice. The real rounds are here. So we started out, these two rounds were always the first two rounds. So this is where they had the consumption and they had a standard lottery allocation and a standard savings decision, right? So they allocated their lump sum across these three. Three and four, this is where we introduced the lottery linked savings version or the lottery linked savings product. And here, in these final columns, it's going to be between sessions. So we randomize sessions between a lottery-linked savings product that has the same return as the savings product. So the expected return is the same as the savings, and then other sessions were randomly assigned to this lower return treatment where the lottery-linked savings product was calibrated so that the return was slightly less than the interest rate on the savings product. And then the final block are these two that are low risk. So in these two, the proportion of the principal that's returned is higher. So there's sort of less risk on the principal. The expected return is the same, and we get there just by changing the proportion that's returned as Lotto credit. These two as a block, three and four and five and six, those rounds are randomly sequenced according to each. Or within each session. Okay, so here's what we see as total savings across the rounds. One and two before lottery-linked savings was introduced. Lottery-linked savings introduced in the darker gray bars, and you see this sort of progression in higher rates of savings across those the rounds where lottery-linked savings is on the menu. So we can estimate the effects more precisely. We use these participant fixed effects to estimate the effect on total savings of the presence of lottery linked savings option on the menu, and control for other things, cluster standard errors, we can control for that order dummy, and then we can do some stuff with heterogeneous effects with these preferences that we elicit, including misperception of probabilities and risk aversion and other. So here are the main results. When the lotto-linked savings product is offered, you see this. This is the sort of the effect size here is probably easier to look at. About 22% increase in savings when lotto-linked savings product is on the menu. You can sort of think about savings in a different way and different measures of savings. One is think of total savings plus interest plus expected winnings. That increases to about 33%. And then, interestingly, with the low risk lottery-linked savings, so that's the version that returns more of the principal as mobile money and less of it in lotto credit. The effect on savings goes up to about 30%. So we see this sort of interesting, and I've done a lot of risk experiments, and you often see this sort of seemingly contradictory effect where on average people are sort of risk loving, they're engaged in lottery play, but on the margin they actually prefer to reduce their risk exposure. So the heterogeneous effects, I won't go through those in great detail, but to give you a sense of that magnitude, that 22% increase in savings is about twice the savings increase that in the experiment is induced by doubling or by raising the interest rate on the savings product from 5 to 20%. So it's at least within the experiment, sort of external validity is sort of always a question in these lab in the field experiments, but at least within the experiment, the magnitude of the savings increase is actually, I think, pretty big. We can look at where that added savings comes from, right? So we see that the additional saving is coming from predominantly a reduction in lottery spending of about 40%, a reduction in traditional savings of about 33%, and then some diverted from consumption. The net effect of these portfolio changes is to increase the expected return on the portfolio by 7 to 8 percentage points. And then finally, this is the only heterogeneous one I'll mention, is that that savings response is strongest for those who consistently overweight small probabilities or who saved less in the rounds before the lottery-linked savings product was offered. So just to kind of wrap up as I mentioned, the external validity in all of these is sort of an interesting design question, interesting to sort of interpret results with external validity in mind. In this case, I think it helps that this prototype lottery-linked savings product actually was built on mobile money, a mobile money platform. It was built on a an SMS-based lottery product. So there was something sort of externally valid in the prototype. In fact, the prototype was designed so if either of these companies wanted, if they were willing to sort of launch something, that it would not be hard to design and launch from where we left off. But still, the validity questions sort of remain open here. These questions about product design and profitability are I think big in this case. One of the things we wanted to sort of explore was how the expected value of the product from the perspective of the firm, how the savings response changed as you reduced the expected cost of the product to the firm. And we see that actually the response is sort of impervious to sort of changes in those expected returns that would reduce the cost to the firm. The broader ethical questions I think are interesting here. The underlying design objective here is to construct a bridge that goes one way from gambling to savings. But of course, there's always a risk once you build the bridge that traffic is flowing in the opposite direction, and that you're sort of inducing people into gambling that otherwise would be saving. In our case, we actually don't think that's as big a problem. We can actually look at what people do with the credit we give them. We can look at those who saved. We can do what we can within the experiment. And I don't think that sort of reverse direction is a big problem here. But it's clearly something that deserves careful attention. In particular, I mean, that question really depends. So there you see that this is the correlation. So we can track people after the experiment to see if they add their own money to the SMS lottery credit or the SMS account. And there's almost no correlation between how they respond, the savings response within the experiment and their subsequent contribution to their account. This last point I think is an important one, which is whether we should worry about the risks involved, kind of the ethical issues of tinkering with these gambling incentives, has a lot to do with what model we think is explaining gambling. We have some ongoing work with this SMS lottery company to try to fit different models, an addiction model, sort of the misperception models. And depending on which model you think is most important at explaining lottery play, you know, you may worry more or less about the sort of the risks of merging savings with lottery play. And I'll end there.
Okay.
How does the inflation rate in Haiti relate to the actual interest rate they're able to get on their savings accounts? And is it, you know, might they be motivated to keep as little cash around as possible and try to go for the big wins if they can't be compensated in their savings accounts?
Yeah. So that's an important question for trying to understand these really high levels of lottery play, right? I mean, this is 80% of Haitians are not banked. I mean, they have no sort of access to financial services. So it's less, I think, about the inflation rate. It's more about just the kind of the chaos of daily life in Haiti. And I think there really is a perception among many Haitians that saving money at home probably has a negative interest rate. I mean, they don't expect that to grow over time, and in fact, you know, subject to all the shocks that characterize daily life in Haiti. So I think part of this proclivity to gamble on the lottery is this perception that they don't really have very many outside options that are better than that. Specific to the experiment here, the 5% and the 20% expected returns on those savings products that we built into the experiment, those are way higher than what they would be getting in a bank. I mean, so this was not meant to sort of replicate savings products they would have access to. It was meant to sort of give a design within the design that allows us to compare and get that internal validity. But it's an important point that this is a chaotic place with maybe negative expected returns on saving money at home.
Yep. Do you know the actual inflation rate in Haiti?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, the actual inflation rate currently, I think, is about 15%. So it changes like everything in Haiti. It changes month to month and in pretty big swings.
Where there's more risk of crime, so saving at home would be riskier, or there might be more social pressure, or do, because preference-based stories, a lot of preference variation is very much at the individual level. Exactly. And so it seems like you could tease that apart a little bit.
By looking at different regions and so we don't have a good sense of that. I mean, there's actually been there's not been a lot of work that we've done. Some phone surveys just to try to get some levels of like how much lottery play there actually is. We can look spatially with the SMS stuff because we have all that data, and we can look kind of using tower locations. We can identify where, but it's really hard to. It becomes hard in Haiti because once you're outside of urban areas in Haiti, access to smartphones and there's a lot of things that change. So we haven't been able to do that. We have thought about that because I'm sure there are some really interesting patterns. All of the real action, and I didn't mention this. I mean, 95% of the lottery play is through the stalls, right? So the SMS platform is really a kind of a minority player at this point. And it would be great if you had better data on the stall action. I mean, that's where it all is, and that's where you'd want to have it. But,
yeah. Given the shorted, the elongated nature of this session, plenty of questions are allowed. So if anyone has a question, go for it.
Have you looked at heterogeneity within the family or in terms of individuals and the extent to which individuals might be able to control the resources they have at home and different kinds of family structures, how that might influence their decisions about savings and lottery?
Yeah, so in this study, we have not. This experiment was, we were recruiting a little bit more on the subject pool. We were recruiting from working poor neighborhoods in peri-urban Port-au-Prince. We had something like two-thirds male, one-third female, mostly single, who were sort of underemployed. We didn't get anything about kind of what the family life is. We know a lot about food security. These are like 75% of them are food insecure by standard measures. These are very poor, kind of working poor households. So we know something about the households, but not enough about kind of the dynamics within the household to say. I will say that I mentioned this thesis by a former student of mine, Rachel Bernstein. So she did a big phone survey, and she was really interested in whether Haitians think about lottery investments as part of a broader financial portfolio. Right, and this is like to get a sense of what's motivating this kind of this degree of play, and she estimates some models, and she gets really strong evidence that they're making savings. Kind of these are informal savings. This is kind of in Roscas, and so informal savings decisions and lottery decisions are very much joint decisions. And if you estimate it as a portfolio, you see strong evidence that these are portfolio decisions, right? These are so when Haitians when they tell us that they think about lottery play as an investment, or they think about lottery, their reason to play the lottery is because they have a goal. When you look at the data and you try to get like their different financial transactions and line them up in a portfolio, the model suggests some consistency there, right? That there is evidence that the lottery is fitting into kind of a broader portfolio. Within the household, though, we don't know. Yeah.
Sort of on that note, I wonder if you or like other researchers in this field has thought about like constructing a fairer lottery or one where you kind of win more often that would kind of resemble more like a savings product. Have you thought about that or has someone done that?
Yeah, so at least in this case, in this context, I don't think so. My original idea was if you could demonstrate the viability of a lotto-linked savings product to kind of channel financial activity into savings, that then you might be able to find a way to kind of, in fact, the Sean Penn Foundation has a lot of work in Haiti, and the director of the Sean Penn Foundation was actually interested at some point in like, well, you know, we'd be interested if you could demonstrate that, we'd be willing to kind of subsidize it so you could offer more favorable kind of more favorable odds on the lottery. The challenge is in this case, the challenge is that the underlying lottery is the menu of games in the lottery is very well known to Haitians. And I don't think you would want to change it too much, right? Because it's the familiarity with the lottery and this number selection that is a big part of it. I will say though, so we calibrated everything as if it was this simple lottery where you choose one two-digit number, and that has that expected return of minus 20%. That's as good as it gets in the Haitian lottery. Minus 20% is pretty good. All the more sophisticated games with big multiples, it drops off dramatically from there. I mean, most of those games have an expected return of maybe minus 80%, minus 85%. So minus 20% is actually pretty good by standards of the other games. But I think that in the design of the product, that's where you sort of have a continuous, you have a knob there you can dial up, which is how much lottery credit do you give versus how much principal do you return, right? So that's where you can sort of give them a higher expected return by just changing the weighting on those two things.
Great.
Yep.
Thanks, Travis.
Thanks.